When I began planning the video about Louis' work, I realized that his work is difficult to appreciate without at least an elementary understanding of the background behind thermodynamics in cement. In this video, we will discuss the most important thermodynamic concepts with simple, cement-based examples. Most people find thermodynamics horribly abstract, so I hope I manage to make ideas clear. In any case, I also provide a wealth of references on the NanoCem webpage below this video for further information. What is thermodynamic modeling? Let's start our journey by looking at a cement from a thermodynamic point of view. We have the clinker, if still present, the pore solution with some dissolved ions, and some, and this list is certainly not exhaustive, hydrate faces. Please note that this picture is strongly simplified. CSH is of course a story on its own, and other hydrate faces such as monosulfur aluminate exist in different hydration states, but we do not worry about this detail for the moment. Thermodynamics assumes that these different faces sit next to each other and are in contact. For example, monosulfur aluminate may dissolve or precipitate from the solution, but otherwise the spatial arrangement does not matter. Thermodynamic modeling can now make statements about the relative stability of these faces. Stability means whether there are processes, for example chemical reactions or phase transitions, which lead to the consumption of a certain phase. Questions can be asked like this. Is CSH stable in the presence of monosulfur aluminate and a pore solution of a certain composition? At a given relative humidity, which hydration states of Ettringite are stable? The answers to these questions are important for almost all aspects of the production and use of cement. To answer these questions, thermodynamic modeling needs an essentially experimental database which contains information about two things. First, the states of the system, and second, possible processes, reactions if you want so, which the system can undergo. During the most of the remaining part of this video, we will explore what this actually means. To go ahead with the final result, by doing a small set of experiments to get thermodynamic data, we can make predictions over a wide range of conditions, which would otherwise need complete sets of own experiments to be characterized. However, one must keep one thing in mind. Not all components of the systems always behave ideal. That's why thermodynamic modeling can only be a guide. It can never totally replace experiments. We will now try to develop a feeling what states and processes are in the thermodynamic sense. We consider a friendly example from Lewis' thesis. The dehydration of monosulfur aluminate with 10.5 water molecules to monosulfur aluminate with 9 water molecules. The statements we make here are always true. Whether one considers a dehydration process, a dissolution or precipitation process, or a funky organic reaction. The left and right side of the reaction are thermodynamic states. It is important to specify the state completely. This includes pressure, temperature, and the state of matter. Note that water here is gaseous. To keep things simple, one normally refers to a standard state labeled by a degree sign at standard conditions, which basically means room temperature and ambient pressure. The three most important thermodynamic measures which characterize a process are the reaction enthalpy, the reaction entropy, and the reaction free enthalpy. The delta indicates a change during the process. This means that each state has assigned values for H, S, and G, which change as the system moves between these states. We will look at this in a minute in more detail. This is to be understood as follows. For example, if 1 mole of MS10.5 dehydrates to 1 mole of MS9 and 1.5 moles of water, the enthalpy of the system changes by this amount. Remember, we are interested in knowing whether MS10.5 is stable or whether it will decompose under certain conditions to MS9. This is what we learn from the free reaction enthalpy. Due to the definition of the free enthalpy G, the free reaction enthalpy, delta RG, tells us whether a process is going to happen or not. If delta RG is smaller than zero, the process occurs from the left to the right. If it is larger than zero, the reverse process should occur. And if it's zero, then we have chemical equilibrium. In other words, nothing happens macroscopically. The first aim of thermodynamic modeling is to obtain delta RG for the processes concerned. It can be measured or calculated from tables if the thermodynamic properties of the substances are known. The next thing we need to understand is the concept of a variable of state and how thermodynamics is distinct from chemical kinetics. To do so, we consider a very well-known example which has little to do with cement, the reaction of hydrogen and oxygen to gaseous water. The reaction happens to be tabulated in standard references and its free energy is clearly smaller than zero. But you have also certainly heard, and most likely even seen at one point in your life, that if we mix oxygen and hydrogen in a test tube, very little happens. Only if we light it, it burns and water is formed. This is because at 25 degrees C, the reaction simply does not happen. This has kinetic reasons which go beyond thermodynamics and this video. We therefore say, at 25 degrees C, hydrogen and oxygen are metastable towards water. This does not make the statement from the free enthalpy wrong. It is a consequence from the fact that the free enthalpy is a state variable. This means that the free enthalpy of the system depends only on the state the matter is in, not on the history of the sample. Therefore, it does not make a statement whether a realistic reaction path exists which enables a phase transition. It only says, if there were a suitable reaction path between the two states, this is its preferred direction. This also explains why we cannot trust thermodynamics alone. Even if we know all thermodynamic properties of all phases concerned, we do not know whether these suitable chemical paths exist. In Lewis' thesis, you will find many examples. Therefore, the thermodynamic database built for cement needs both thermodynamic information about the phases in cement, but also information about which reactions are observed and which are not. To really understand what the free enthalpy is, we just draw it as an axis. Along this axis, we arrange some of the states we have been talking about. Hydrogen and oxygen could be plotted here, water here. The free reaction enthalpy is this. We have already stated that if the free reaction enthalpy of a process is negative, it occurs spontaneously. Thus, G indicates accessibility. If the free enthalpy of a state 1 is higher than of a state 2, the system can move from 1 to 2 provided there is a suitable chemical path. Let's look as a second example on something more practical, the hydration process MS9 to MS10.5. The reaction has a negative free reaction enthalpy, therefore we might insert the product and the reactant state in the diagram like this. This process and its reverse process are actually observed at room temperature, so there is no kinetic problem. We could also insert now a state with the elements forming MS9 and MS10.5. Since MS9 and MS10.5 do not spontaneously disintegrate in their atomic components, one can assume that this state has a high free enthalpy, so we plot it like this. On the other hand, it is safe to assume that a mixture of calcium, hydrogen, oxygen, sulfur and aluminium does not spontaneously form MS9 or MS10.5, so we can assume that the state of the elements is metastable relative to MS9 and MS10.5. Since the free enthalpy depends only on the state, we can also do something else. The difference MS10.5 to MS9 plus 1.5 H2O is the difference between the differences of the two states to the state of the pure elements. Therefore, we can calculate delta RG by considering the relative difference to the elements. You may have already noticed that the formation of any component from the elements is not denoted by delta RG but delta FG. F for formation. These values are part of any thermodynamic database because they facilitate the calculation we have just outlined. It may be noted that this principle also works in the other direction. Assume we know the free enthalpy of formation of MS10.5 and I want to know the one of MS9. I can do this simply by rearranging this equation. More information can be found in thermodynamic textbooks as Hess' law. How can we now measure these things? Again, we return to our example MS10.5 to MS9 plus 1.5 water. In Lewis' thesis and textbook chapters about the free enthalpy and the mass action law, you will find expressions like this. It says that the free energy of the reaction is concentration dependent. Remember, the delta Rg refers only to the change pure MS10.5 to pure MS9 in pure gaseous water. This means for the latter state that the two substances sit in separated beakers next to each other. The term in the logarithm includes the concentration effect. The general expression is products, right side, over educts, or reactants, left side. And note that the stoichiometric coefficient goes in the exponent. The brackets indicate that this is a special concentration measure. It is called the activity. The activity accounts for the non-ideal behavior of materials at very high concentrations or pressures. We have to refer you to thermodynamic textbooks for details. However, for teaching purposes, it is sufficient to note that solids have an activity of 1. Often, for simple teaching calculations, one can ignore activities and replace them by concentrations, typically the mole fractions. Returning to our example, this means that now the free energy depends on the logarithm of the relative humidity, the saturation vapor pressure, the standard pressure, and the fugacity coefficient, this is the activity for gases, are all constant at constant temperature and pressure. If we plot now the free enthalpy of the process at constant temperature against the relative humidity, we find at 2% at 25 degrees C, delta Rg becomes 0. That means the reaction stops. More practical, consider a test tube filled with pure MS10.5 and dry air. We now plot the free enthalpy of the total system versus the reaction number. This is just a fraction of MS10.5 consumed. Initially, we are here. However, with time, MS10.5 decomposes and reduces the free energy of the system till delta Rg becomes 0. By repeating this experiment at different temperatures, we can plot a diagram like this, which most people will recognize as a phase diagram, relative humidity versus temperature. Since we know that at equilibrium delta Rg equals 0, we can now calculate the standard free reaction enthalpy from the equilibrium moisture content. During the discussion of Lewis' work, we will see how we can obtain the enthalpy and entropy from the temperature-dependent data as well. We have learned how thermodynamics can be used to comment on the stability of coexisting phases. The power of this method comes from the fact that these statements remain true even in more complex systems, also in the complex Semen showed earlier. Now, questions can be asked like, first, most of these solid phases have different hydration states. At a given relative humidity, which hydration state prevail? If we have a given solution composition, which solid phases in cement are stable? This comes from the fact that the same theory represented here is also behind solubility constants. In fact, the solubility constant is proportional to the argument in the logarithm here. Thermodynamic modeling software like GEMS can be used with this data to investigate systems which are much more complex than what we have discussed. Just think about our previous experiment with the sealed test tube, but imagine now there is some water saturated ettringite present as well. Which phases will be present at the end at which equilibrium relative humidity? We have learned that the total system will always try to minimize its free energy, so we need to figure out which phase composition has the lowest free energy. This is what thermodynamic modeling software like GEMS does. It minimizes the free energy of the system within the constraints of the initial chemical composition, which means, of course, mass is conserved. This is a motivation for work like Lewis's thesis. The thermodynamic software is only as good as its mostly experimental database, which needs to contain the thermodynamic information of all substances and the corresponding processes which they may undergo. Obtaining this information is truly not trivial. We are not just talking about the type of information presented in this video, but also less easy to access information about the ion uptake of solid phases, complex formation in aqueous phases, and so on. Let's talk about some take-home messages. Thermodynamic modeling enables us to arrange the states. These are compositions, phase assemblages, and so on, along an axis G, which is a free enthalpy. If a state A is on a higher G value than B, then B is accessible from A. This means if there is a suitable chemical transformation, such as a dissolution, a precipitation or dehydration, it will occur. This if has to be figured out experimentally. Thermodynamics cannot predict whether there is a possible chemical path between the two states A and B. How is my work in practice is the topic of the video about Louis' multi-method approach to assess the hardware stability. I hope that this primer to the most important ideas of thermodynamics is helpful to the interested audience. However, it is far from comprehensive. Truly understanding of thermodynamics can only be gained by studying one of the references below.